construction of it, but it is by far and away, if it, other than this one, his most northern building, it is Maryborough Library. And this is the only one, this is the only known building of his that I've actually been to.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's some of the hotels I wanted to talk about. As I said, there are quite a few other ones, but those sort of give a flavor of the different styles. This is another building here, the CBD. This was designed in 1926 for Eva Sanderson, who was a dentist. So it still carries out a similar function as a medical practice now. And so it's kind of unusual that you had a dental surgery, although he did design Finnemore is also the CBD, but it kind of stands out as being an unusual building for the CBD. I've included this one because, as I said before, he did a lot of alterations and additions, and he did sort of the awning here at the Royal Hotel. So the council made a decision that that you can no longer have post-supported awnings. You have to start using cantilever awnings, so he picked up quite a bit of work. So he did that very artistic, and I encourage you to walk underneath it and see sort of, it was described as having a bunch of artistry. It's a very beautiful structure that he added. He also in the 1930s did a lot of additions to the internals of the Royal Hotel, including the bar area. And yeah, that's a good shot of the awning design. Another one of the top two parts. This is a structure that he built for Maryborough to get power supply. Now it then became TAFE and now church. So this was in 1922. This 1932, it replaced the earlier. Maryborough got power in 1922, but he designed this structure in 1932. It is everything you see there he designed, but it was something of a shell around an earlier furniture factory. The actual building took its form. He designed the theaters in Maryborough, the different competing theaters, and this was the Embassy Theater. And obviously, just to the left of it, you can see the Carlton Hotel. This is typical of his 1930s residences. So this is on the corner of Churchill and Lennox Street. I don't think it's the original paint scheme though. So this was for the Sheldon family, and this is 1934. This flat area over here was the tennis court. Maryborough used to have a really strong tennis culture, both private and sort of public courts, and all the servants of their own teams competed against each other. There's a great book called Anyone for Tennis that the Family History Societies put together. So this building, which was done for a major client, the Sheldon family, sort of encapsulates a few things that he liked to do. He really made use of corner blocks. A lot of his houses were on corner blocks. And he always acknowledged the corner by having a bay window here or truncating the corner. And he always had prominent entranceways. So as I'll show you in a couple of the slides, he varies on a curving stairway. This is a block further towards us, and this is the corner of Lennox and North Street. This was 2 years later in 1936, and again, a very prominent family, of course, a family in Maryborough history. So at the time, the Chronicle reported, the residents will incorporate several new features in home builder's art. Carried out entirely from the timbers of the district, the home will be a very comfortable one and present a pleasing appearance. Papered walls and a modernly equipped tall bathroom will be features of the house. So again, this is where their tennis court was, on this flat grass area here. Here's the college corner, and that's the prominent entranceway. This is two blocks the other way, and again on the corner block, the prominent entrance and acknowledged the corner is called Corinna, and it was designed in 1932. It cost £3,000, which is quite a lot of money at the time. That was for Herb Williams, who was a prominent businessman here. So these buildings are in the California bungalow style, which is popular in Maryborough in the mid-1920s to late 1930s. This has also got what people would say arts and crafts style architectural features. This is, I'll show you a few other buildings. So he did grand buildings as well as, so this building is opposite the Engineers Arms. It's a real estate office now. But when he designed it in the, I think about 1925, it was one of our earlier petrol stations. And quite an interesting building if you look at it closely. This is on, I think the corner of, Sussex and Cheapside. And it was for the City Butchering Company. So you can see quite a large behind the buildings. A few names kept coming up, like Charles Tipton, F.D.G. Stanley, Herb Farrakhan, Henry Palmer. But one that seemed to come up all the time, and if you walked down the street right now, you'd see four or five of his buildings, was Philip Oliver Eller Hawks, who most commonly went under the name P.O.E. Hawks. So I sort of, and it sort of really enlivened my interest that while his name came up, we didn't know anything about him. So somebody who was so responsible for the look and feel of Maryborough, for Maryborough's streetscapes, was virtually unknown. So I started to do some research on him and learn a bit more about him. Unfortunately, it's quite hard because he didn't leave behind much family. He didn't leave behind documents. So the most that we have to go on of is, in fact, buildings. Back then, the Chronicle reported a lot more on building openings, so we have a lot of newspaper reports. We also have minutes from all the organizations he was involved in and the outgoing correspondence from the council. Unfortunately, all the letters that were sent to the council during that era were destroyed by the arson attack on City Hall in 1990, but for some reason, the carbon copies of the council's correspondence were kept elsewhere. So I've got half the correspondence as well. So that's how I'm able to recreate his life. And I'm very conscious that if somebody in 80 years' time tried to recreate my life from newspaper stories, that it would give a wildly inaccurate impression of me. but this is all we have to go on. And I think he's somebody who deserves a lot more recognition for somebody who is so responsible. And as I looked into it further, it was so much more than Maryborough. I'll show you some ones really far north. I'll show you where he was around the country. So Philip was born in 1882 in Wagga Wagga. There's one line of his family that's very easy to research family history. If you do family history research, you'll know that some families are easier to research than others. You can actually trace the Hawks line back to 1600, because he was that was Irish nobility. And so Philip's older brother was John Hawks, because every firstborn son of that generation, there's like 15 John Hawks going back. So Philip was the second. His grandfather on his maternal side was Philip Oliver Eller, so he also came, and he was named after him. So he came from two quite distinguished Irish families. But he was born in Wagga Wagga, where his father was the town clerk and very involved in the community. So he never knew any profession other than architecture. He became an article clerk to George Shepherd, who was the main architect in Wagga Wagga at the time. And if you go to Wagga Wagga now, a lot of the streetscapes, he did all the tree planting. So there's a lot of mature trees that were planted by George Shepherd when Philip was there. So he did his articles with George for a number of years, I think almost up to 10 years. And by that stage, he was qualified to set out and become an architect. But what he did was, for the next 5 years, he traveled as far as he could to get as many, to gain his skills. So he wanted, so even though he'd got all this significant training working in an architecture firm, he was very, in 1905, he set out to really get as much skills right across the country. So he started out in Wagga Wagga, obviously, which is around Canberra. Wagga Wagga is almost spread between Sydney and Melbourne, which put it briefly into contention for the being capital. It could have been the capital because it was, rather than starting afresh in Canberra, but for one reason or another, they decided to go with Canberra, maybe because New South Wales didn't want to give up Wagga Wagga. Wagga Wagga means, in the indigenous language there, the place of many crows. And I think it's actually oniopathic, where sound sounds like it is, like the crows go wagga, wagga. So that's why the indigenous word for crows is wagga. So he got his training in Wagga, grew up in Wagga Wagga. And then in 1905, he got the ferry, the ship from Sydney to Fremantle. And then for the next year and a bit, he worked in a private firm in the government office in Perth. He didn't stay there very long. So then from Perth, he then went to Launceston and worked in a couple of different private practices for about a year. And then he went to Melbourne and worked in a number of different practices. It was there in Melbourne that he was actually working with Henry Palmer. Henry Palmer was the grandson of the first mayor of Maryborough by the same name. And we think that Henry Palmer told Hawkes about how great the Wye Bay area was. And so then when he finished up in Melbourne, then he made his way to Brisbane, where he worked for the state government. And it was Alfred Barton Brady who designed the Lamington Bridge, which is a few years earlier, finished by 1896. But Alfred Barton Brady, who's this guy, he employed Hawkes, and Hawkes learned a lot from him in this brief period working for the Queensland government. And then Hawkes, in his final employment, worked for another private law firm. And so that took him up to 1910. So in that space of 1905 to 1910, he had gained a lot of experience right across the country working for the major architects of the day. In 1910, he made the decision to step out on his own and to rely on his own skills and reputation by moving to Bundaberg and setting up. He'd never been to Bundaberg before. He chose it. I think it was because it's right the same size as Wagga Wagga. He could see that it was growing as a result of the sugar industry and the port. So he set up there in Wagga Wagga. He lived in the Royal Hotel, which is still partly there. It's been taken over by shops. So that's what you would have seen most days. That's the main staircase of the hotel. And so there, and I've got another photo actually too. That's the main dining room where he would have had his meals occasionally. The Royal Hotel is actually quite, it's most well known because a quarter of a century before Hawkes lived there, the sugar farmers who owned the plantations met there to discuss what they wanted to do with a waste product, molasses, which was heavy and difficult to dispose of, and it was too expensive to turn it into cow feed. So they decided in that very hotel that they would start the Bundaberg Rum Company. With that waste product. So the hotel where he was living is actually more famous because of its association with the rum. In that brief period, he became very, very involved with a number of different associations. He's almost within months of starting there, the Bundaberg Bowls Club held its committee meetings there. He was on the Stedford Committee, and he was on the School of Arts. So he became very, very involved, and that's how he got a lot of his clients. One of his first major commissions, this is still a landmark there. You see the date there, 1913 on it. This is now the Linden Medical Clinic, but he built it for Dr. Schmidt. Like most buildings like these in regional CBDs, you have professional offices. In this case, a surgery downstairs and then the residence upstairs. You can see it's actually kind of a cluttered building. It's got a lot going on in it. So it's quite unusual and distinctive. So he did that from Dr. Schmidt, and it was quite significant that he got that commission within a couple of years of arriving into this new town when there were established architects already there. And so he wasn't, obviously Bundaberg was the center for quite a wide region. This was another very early building of his. And again, it's got an interesting sort of roof feature like that, like the Linden Clinic. This is, as you can see, the Grand Hotel of Gangtop. So this was £2,500 in 1912, which is quite a significant amount back then. And this is one of his very early major commissions. So he worked in Bundaberg for a few years, but by 1913, he had joined with Henry Palmer to form the firm of Hawkes and Palmer. And Hawkes moved to King Arroy, but he kept his Bundaberg office. So the firm existed from about 1913 to 1918, with Palmer operating the Maryborough office on Wharf Street, and then Hawkes operated the King Arroy and Bundaberg offices. This is one of the buildings he designed, I think one of his nicest churches. I'll show you a few of his churches, but this is the Catholic Church in Menango. And this was completed by 1917. During that time, obviously during World War I, the amount of work they had dropped off quite a bit. just the war effort. It was quite surprising that this was even built between 1915 and 1917. It's quite a beautiful building inside. I got to go take these photographs just before they've got scaffolding over it now because they're doing the restoration work before its centenary later this year. When it originally opened, actually, this statue of the Virgin Mary wasn't there because they intended it. This was open here and it was going to go there. When it came from Italy, it was too large, so they had to change that around a bit. But if you look at the turrets, as I'll show you some other buildings later, these turrets are quite identical to what you'll see at St. Paul's Memorial Hall, as well as at St. Mary's. So that's sort of a continuing design feature that he had for the church buildings. This is the only known photograph we have of Hawkes. We found this in the Maryborough Historical Society's archives, and it's photo of him. The actual whole photo is of four men. It's the 1922 Maryborough Stedford Committee. So that shows him in 1922, which I guess would put him at about 40. About 40. So when he moved to King Arroy, he received some work to do the Tabinga Hotel. And I'll show you some hotels this later. He received a lot of commissions to do hotels. Often after they burnt down, it was quite shocking the amount of hotels in this region that burnt down. But he ended up marrying the daughter of the hotel owner in Tabinga, Hilda. And she's from Tabinga, which is a suburb, a township just south of King Arroy, where the other Petersons are from, actually. And they had two children, Lorraine in 1916 and John in 1920. So they all moved to Maryborough in 1918-1919 period. So during the war, he did enlist, and if you saw the very first slide, you'd see the signature was over his signature when he enlisted. He enlisted and he was based in the camp in Brisbane for a matter of about a week. And then Hilda had a lot of pregnancy issues and he had to be discharged to go back and take care of her. So the marriage wasn't a very happy one. So what you see here is actually just two lines out of the 1925 electoral roll. And this is in the period, the electoral roll starts to get a bit more useful in about 5 or 6 more years when they start putting the number in the street. Like later electoral rolls would actually tell you the actual house in Palace Street. But what you see here is Hilda is still living in Palace Street and he'd become a bachelor, moved into Custom House Hotel, and that's where he lived for the rest of his time in Maryborough. The children were sent to live with maternal grandparents in King Arroy. Hilda eventually went further north and lived up near Cairns in Yungaburra. So yeah, they didn't stay together for very long. And that can probably explain his prolific output, that he was in the city, CBD, around all his clients within walking distance to his office, that he could focus so heavily on his activities, his professional activities. This was one of his early buildings, right near his house, right near his residence, actually, right almost next door to the Custom House Hotel. So this was one of his early buildings for the Finnemore Dental Surgery. And so this this was built in 1919.
I think that's the tender notice. So the tenders went out in November 1918.
So he received a lot of commissions from different, from all the leading sort of citizens in Maryborough within months of arriving. And that had a lot to do with his hobbies and his interests. So he did classical music, he was a membership of different societies, like the Gentlemen's Club, the Freemasons, the Debating Society. He went on to become the president of the Duneville Bowls Club. He gave lectures on architecture, was involved in the School of Arts, the Stedford, which is why we have that photo of him. You know, basically, he joined a lot of different things. He managed to be a judge at trade union parades at the same time as nominating the Conservative candidate for Parliament. So he was very involved. His commissions came from the Church of England at the same time as the Catholic Church, from competing cinemas. So he was well known to everyone within months of arriving. He gave free advice to different organizations like QCWA, and that really cemented his reputation as being the leading architect very quickly. He was known as being very eccentric. he had a sort of a reputation of, you know, sometimes he'd arrive at building sites in the middle of the night in his pajamas. He was extremely bad at paperwork, and just quite, you know, frantically rushing between different sites. So this is another one of his very early buildings. He actually won this, got the commission for this one, and we'll talk about the Laurel Hall up front, through a competition. So that was, I'll talk a bit more about war memorials. So that was a memorial, obviously, after World War I. And that was 1920 to 1921. And it, as you can see, it harmonizes extremely well with much earlier church and belfry tower in sort of a Gothic style. But again, I mentioned before the turrets, when you go to the Catholic Church, are almost identical with cardinal turrets, same positioning. So after, before World War I, there were basically hardly any memorials in Australia. There just weren't memorials. But before hostilities even finished, almost any size town and settlement in Australia started to do memorials to people who had sacrificed so much during the war. And that ranged from honor boards to buildings to parks. And Hawkes, by virtue of his deep community involvement, his creativity and his skills, was called upon to do a great number of memorials in this area, like the Pi Alpha Cenotaph Memorial Mall, which I showed you. He won the design for Anzac Park, which was a memorial which never got built, unfortunately. They ended up giving it to the golf club, as well as a number of other buildings at the Gumeri and all the memories. But perhaps his most famous is this one, the Cenotaph, which was very controversial at the time. The committee had already decided another location, Anzac Park, before Hawkes had convinced them that this location on the corner here would be the best possible spot. And then once he convinced them of that, he came up with a design, which again was quite controversial. People thought it was too militaristic. But again, now it's, you know, very highly appreciated. This building, he did a lot of, I'll show you a lot of buildings that he did from scratch, but he also did a lot of work, alterations and additions. This is the third floor of Stupart's, which he did in the early 1920s. George Stupart's obviously started this department store, which existed in one form or another for over a century, finally finishing up as David Jones. Hawkes added that top floor to the earlier building. This is typical of what Hawkes was doing from the mid-20s onwards. If you look at his houses, and there, you know, obviously there's houses of his all over Maryborough, as for the earlier style in the start of the 1920s, they were higher set. This is getting lower, higher set timber, and then this is sort of the intermediate period where they, and then later you have more bricks rather than timber. But this is fairly typical of the 1920s house that he was designing. This is obviously the Leamington Hotel. He designed this in 1928 to replace the Ariadne Hotel. It's obviously named after the Leamington, nearby Leamington Bridge, which his former boss had designed. Well, I think I'm going to talk about, I'll talk about some of his hotels now. As I often said to my wife Melissa, one time very soon we're going to go on a 2-week sort of trip right around Wye Bay and actually further afield, visiting all of his hotels, because you can actually could have, despite the number that have been lost, you actually could have a really pleasant journey driving around, staying and drinking hotels. This one, of course, is just across the corner on the Hotel Carlton, which I think is his nicest one. It's also one of his last buildings. He described the style as jazz style. So this was a major client of his Corcoran company. They owned a lot of hotels and he designed many of them. So this is the late 1930s. It replaced the Ballarat Hotel, which was a very old hotel. So unfortunately, it replaced the run down over the last of this stage. But yes, that's the Hotel Carlton. That was the very late 1930s Corcoran Co. And as you can see, they liked the design a lot. And they, when the Grand Hotel Gumeri, which you'll see, if you go to the Pumpkin Festival in 2 months' time, you'll see this hotel. the Grand Hotel. This is also Corser and Kellman. They asked him to replicate the design there, which you can see he's done identically. It's just got a different surface treatment. So that, despite that, it's not a corner block. So the Carlson Hotel was built specifically like that to be a corner block. They liked it so much, they just asked for it to be replicated in the area. This is one of his earliest hotels, and perhaps one of the nicest locations other than Maryborough, Pomona Hotel. I need to go back when there's a bit better light, but this is obviously around dusk. But Pomona Hotel, it's obviously just a bit west of Noosa, and in the shadow of one of the glasshouse mountains. But a very beautiful hotel, and unfortunately it survived from 1913.
That's the century.
This is Kilkeven, another fairly early hotel of his. And I'll show you a few of the ones like this that are quite similar, very similar gabled roofs. I've got this one here. This one no longer exists. It's on the way to Kilkeven. If you're driving to Kilkeven or further afield to Nanango or Kingaroy, Waluga sort of comes along out of nowhere. And so he designed this one. This was a very early one of his, I think in about 1914 or so. And it served a very, I'm showing it to you here because the same, I think it's the same owner, but the same hotel, when it burnt down, they built a hotel, they got Hawks to design another hotel, and he built it, and I'll show you the differences. By the time this was built, they needed, I guess it's a roadside inn for the travelers and the form of communication. But when it burnt down, you know, a decade later, they replaced it with this because of the change in transport and communication in that brief period of time. There was no longer calling for a roadside inn in that fashion. So he got designed both of them, and it sort of just shows you that as much as, you know, you can appreciate his style was obviously conforming to the expectations of his clients and the needs of the buildings at the time. This is the Carol Lee Hotel. Often with these buildings, when it says like with the engineer's arms and other buildings, when it says established, that's to do with the licensees, when they started and then how the hotel burned down or was replaced. He designed this when he was in Kingaroy about 1915. Again, a very nice hotel. This building has been destroyed. I've included this one. I could have a whole file of ones of hotels that are destroyed. This is, I've included this one to show you again. It's the same roof structure with the asymmetrical gables. This is in Proston, or it was until it burnt down in the 1960s. Again, very similar roof. This is the Royal Hotel in Mundubbera. This is, you can see it's very, quite an early one of his, sort of image before 1915, because of the amount of decoration. They got, he never would have designed something like this like in the 1930s, because they were more after simple, functional buildings. This is one that's sadly been lost. This is the site of the Beach House Hotel. To design this, actually, it was two buildings. It was this building and there was this building. He was given the commission to make them whole. So the building, you know, the concept and the design and the look of the hotel was his. But he started out with two separate buildings, which he had to sort of bridge together. This is an example of one of his later hotels in the 1930s. If you drive to Agnes Water, you should stop in Merriam-Vale. It's quite a nice hotel, but again, as you can see, the change of fashions in the 1930s was much more into plainer, more functional buildings. This is another one, a later one. This actually was a mystery for me for quite some time. This is the Tolga Hotel. Tolga is actually a community near Yungaburra, 1,400 kilometers to the north. So it was actually, I was actually really confused about this one for many months. I sort of thought it had something to do with Hilda, because Hilda went up after this, as far as I knew, after this building was built, but she lived very near this hotel in the 1930s. So I thought he must have gone up there to try and rekindle a relationship, and at the time pick up some work and design this hotel. But recently I realized that the owner of the hotel was Mr. Agnew, who also owned the post office hotel here in Maryborough. And Hawks had done some work for him on alterations and additions. So I think Mr. Agnew just really liked Hawks, and so he decided to engaged into designing a hotel from scratch, 1400 kilometers to the north. So I don't know if Hawks ever would, it did get the train up there.